Good afternoon. We're going to go ahead and open up the study session. Can we have a roll call, please?
Councilwoman Zendejas? Councilwoman Allen?
Present.
Councilwoman Price? Councilman Supranà? Councilwoman Mungo? Councilwoman Saro?
Present.
Councilmember Yuranga?
Present.
Councilman Austin?
Here.
Vice Mayor Richardson?
I am here.
Mayor Garcia?
All right, Mayor Garcia has a family commitment. He won't be here this evening, so we're going to go ahead and get started. Let's read the agenda item, please.
Recommendation to hold a study session to receive and file a presentation and update on citywide infrastructure needs and funding strategies.
All right, Mr. Modica?
Thank you, Vice Mayor, members of the City Council. We have a fairly lengthy presentation in our study session today. The council, I hear from every one of you how important infrastructure is to you, to your constituents. We've made a lot of progress on some key infrastructure projects, but we know this is a long-term solution, a long-term problem. We're going to have long-term solutions. It's an issue that faces every city, how to keep up with your infrastructure, how much to invest, and how to do that. So we have a lot of things to think about tonight. It's no action tonight, really just information and a chance for the council to ask questions, and then we'll be talking a little bit about what some of those next steps may be. So we will start with a presentation from Eric Lopez, our Public Works Director, to go over our infrastructure and kind of where we are. You'll hear from Tyler Curley, who will talk a little bit about the federal and state resources that are coming to bear and how those may play into what we have to be able to fund. And then I'll talk a little bit about some next steps and criteria for looking at kind of priority projects, as well as some concepts regarding bonding, which we've heard about from the council as well. So I will turn that over to Eric to get started.
Thank you, Tom. Vice Mayor, members of the City Council, we are a large city with a complex large city with a lot of needs. So the process of developing recommendations on what needs to address is a complex one. When we look at our different programs, from street and alleys to bridges to our traffic signals, parks, facilities, community facilities, there is a challenge. In the last few years, we have been able to make investments on planning and master planning efforts that are helping to inform those recommendations. And today I'm going to focus on three of those. The pavement management plan for our streets and alleys, our self-evaluation and transition plan for pedestrian facilities in accordance with the American Disabilities Act, and our facilities conditions assessment that looks at all public facilities, including those related to public safety, our parks, our libraries, parking structures, community center facilities, et cetera. I also want to note that the passage of Measure A about 5 years ago really has allowed us to make a historic investment in our infrastructure, and we've been able to get a lot done, not just projects, but also on the planning sides. And being able to fund some of these proactive planning efforts is really allowing us to create data that will lead to better informed recommendations and decisions. Although I'm going to focus on three major plans and outline some of their recommendations and some of our opportunities and constraints associated with them, I also want to point out that we have other plans that are in need of being updated that also guide our recommendations on an annual basis. Our storm drain master plan, storm water master plan, bridge master plan, bicycle master plan, urban forest plan, those are all either outdated, in the works, or they've been requested by the council and we've been working on. But even though I'm not focusing on them, I just wanted to acknowledge that we're continuously planning and thinking about additional needs and constraints. So I want to start by focusing on the pavement management plan and our street network. We've heard loud and clear that our roadway repair program is one of the more important CIP focus areas. We've been working really hard to be able to deliver more street improvements. I think we've made some great progress. with programs like our residential street repair program, our alley repair program, but obviously there's always room for improvement. So as part of our pavement management plan, we look at every single city roadway and we develop a pavement condition index score that ranges from 0 to 100. 0, it being either dirt or completely dilapidated, and 100, it being a newly paved street. So we have a score for every alley, every local street, every secondary street, every major street within the city, and that's all fed into our pavement management program that's then used to make recommendations to try to find the sweet spot of where we can get the most benefits for each dollar invested. We have our street categories that I'm going to go through on our next slide, and we've stated what percentage of our roadway networks are in each of these category conditions. So on the green, obviously, is the excellent, the very top. 13% of our roads are in that category. And at the bottom in red, you see our very poor streets. And currently, 9% of our roadways are in that category. And you see the rest in between. I want to point out that the cost, the average cost per square foot of repair goes up as you go from streets in good condition to streets in poor condition. And the increase is pretty substantial. As part of our pavement management plan, there's a strong recommendation to minimize and slow down the rate of degradation, roadway degradation, so that we minimize the cost of repairs. And the more we're able to do that, the more we can improve we can do with our maintenance dollars. Our current pavement condition index score, as in this year's pavement management plan that is just being wrapped up, it's a 58. So that's that doesn't change from the last pavement management plan we did. That the last update was done in 2018. But our backlog did slightly increase. We're currently at 26. When we say we have a backlog of 26%, that means our streets that are either in poor or very poor condition is around 26%, which obviously is too high. The recommended backlog for a city of our size and complexities is somewhere around 15-20%. You definitely do not want to be over 20%. So it's just an area of need, an area that we're going to have to figure out how to address to get it back to a more manageable backlog. Our consultants have estimated that the average amount required to maintain our PCI is $58 million a year. That is recommended, where the amount we're able to invest on an annual basis is closer to $30 million a year. So there is a discrepancy there that we're working to address and figure out. I'm often asked, how much will it take to fix all of our streets within a certain amount of time? So we developed a chart to show what the investments would be required if we were to achieve a PCI score of 85 within 5 years. So get all of our streets to a very good condition. The investment in our major network system would need to be just under $600 million. And in our residential minor streets, it'd be about $1 billion. And then in our alleys, around $128 million. The fix-all amount within the five-year period is about $1.77 billion. So obviously, that's not what we're proposing. That's not realistic, but it does give us a really good sense of the scale of the problem with our roadway network. The chart to the right is the percent need per council district for our residential street program. We're often asked what these numbers are, so we've taken them out and we've placed them on the pie chart for your consideration. For the last 5 years, we've been focusing on the 5-year infrastructure investment plan that was made possible by Measure A. So we've been able to do a very comprehensive number of local streets, of major streets, of secondary streets, and we've been able to improve them thanks to the revenues made available by Measure A. But we're not done yet. So wanted to point out the how far we are with the investment plan. Because obviously we are fully committed to finishing our commitments. We just need some additional time to be able to complete them. So for our major streets, we're about 66% complete with our commitments. For our residential streets, we're about 74% complete. And our alleys, about 83%. For the major streets, though, we have segments like our Artesia, Studebaker, Anaheim, and Market that are going to benefit from state and federal funding sources. So that's going to be a big part of being able to fully fund those segments and deliver them. And so I just wanted to clarify that, because we do get funding from Caltrans and Metro and other agencies through the federal and state government that needs to be acknowledged. It's not just Measure A revenues that are funding the program, even though Measure A has made a lot of these projects possible. Taking a quick look at our investment, our 5-year street investment history, and just the amount of money that we've been able to put in to repair our streets has been significant. And I know we need more, but I also want to celebrate what we've been able to do the last 5 years. And I think it's important to acknowledge our teams, especially our residential street improvement team, that's been able to really increase their productivity and do more with the funding that we've made available. Same with our arterial street team and our alley improvement team. So within the last 5 years, our total investment amount is about $194 million. And yes, there's going to be a dip in Measure A funds in the next few years. But we're also hoping to see an increase in investments from the state and federal government. So for the PMP, with this latest update this year, we are looking to release a more public-facing interactive GIS tool where we will allow the public to look at any roadway segment and figure out its condition. And as we improve more of these projects, we want to be able to communicate when it was last improved and or when it's programmed for improvement, just to really help better communicate with the public. So we're working hard on that tool. It's something new for us. We want it to be easily integrated, accessible, and integrated into our Public Works website. But we are looking at its release in the next couple months. Once we finalize our review, our pavement management plan update, we're also going to post a report on the website and offer up meetings and public presentations and obviously discussions with any interested council district. So the next plan I want to focus on is the ADA self-evaluation transition plan. This came out of the city's settlement agreement a few years back, and we've done a lot of critical improvements to improve accessibility, but there's a lot more work that's remaining. So when we look at our citywide, our sidewalks citywide, we have about 1,215 miles. And when we look at the number of total curb ramps we have citywide, we have 12,091. And then as we look to improve accessibility in these areas, We really had to work carefully to plan out our approach and make sure that we are hitting the highest priorities first, and that we are making sure that our investments are providing the highest values possible. So just have some additional information on the slide on how we reviewed all of our different sidewalks and curb ramps and paths of travel, and kind of where we have a lot of needs and what their priorities are. So the map on the right shows sidewalks by priority rank. The red is high priority, yellow is medium priority, and green is low priority. So we've mapped out the whole city, and we know where our highest priorities are and where we need to focus our required investments as part of this plan. The map on the left on this slide shows the missing curb ramps in priority on the left and right, and on the right we have the non-compliant curb ramps. So there's also not only do we have areas where we didn't have curb ramps and we've been working to install them, but we also have areas where the curb ramps installed did not meet the legal requirements and not meet the design requirements. So we've identified all of those locations, and we know where to focus on the highest priorities and work our way down within the plan. The status of meeting the commitments within this plan is outlined on this slide. We've made a lot of progress and delivered a lot of critical improvements, but there are a lot of commitments remain. We're not fully done with the total amount of ramps completed to date, and then we're gonna have to also look at non-compliant curb ramps and sidewalks in future years as well. The investments that have gone into the ADA program to date are total just under $40 million. And that includes a investment of about $15.5 million in this next fiscal year, and there's going to be additional needs that we're going to need to program to meet our requirements for this program. So the next major plan that we've been able to update and really get some good data on is the facilities conditions assessment. This is new for us. We've looked at every public facility in our parks, in our libraries, within our different public safety departments, and we've evaluated their condition. And we have about 150 or so facilities, and overall. We have 91 facilities that are currently in poor condition, 4 that are in very poor condition, 31 that are in good condition, and 30 that are in fair condition. So we're currently going through this data. We're doing our final reviews with our partner departments on each report, working hard to finalize them so that we can start taking a look at all of these individual facilities and making sure we understand their needs and the priorities. We've identified just under $430 million in anticipated facility improvements within the next 10 years. We have the breakdown of the different buildings and their different conditions on this slide. If we weren't to be able to make any investments in our public facilities within the next 10 years, then we've developed a scenario where we've estimated what the change would be in terms of the overall conditions of our facilities. And our facilities in very poor condition would increase to 7. Our facilities in poor condition would increase to 119. Our facilities in fair condition would increase to 22. And our buildings in good condition would equal 8. So obviously we're not going to do that. We're going to continue to do what we can to invest in our buildings, but just provide some good data of the needs out there and just the diversity of facilities. When we look at parks and fire stations and facilities like public restrooms, there is a lot of need out there that we carefully follow. Here's a snapshot of the information we're getting from our facilities conditions assessment. This is an example for Drake Park Community Center, and it really shows the different needs and the immediate capital investment required now and the amount required in the future. This is just for a like-to-like replacement. So oftentimes, we have community centers that are looking to expand or to renovate to better meet the evolution of programs and services. But the FCA gives us a snapshot. If there are desires to do additional improvements, obviously that would cost additional dollars. We have a lot of different needs, we have a lot of different funding sources that goes into our needs. Federal funding, state funding, local funding, Measure A, potential bond opportunities. There's as we look at addressing our infrastructure needs, we have to take a look at these different sources, and determine, how we can leverage our different sources and how we can maximize the amount of benefit that we get. So, we're going to get into the part of the presentation that Tyler's going to provide an overview of potential funding sources from the state and federal government. But those sources are targeted, and we expect them to be associated with specific programs. But just wanted to point out that that as we make decisions on funding recommendations, we have to take into account the different sources. I talked a little bit about the Measure A Infrastructure Investment Plan, and how we've been able to really use that to make some critical improvements, but allowed us to address some of our needs. There's still a lot of needs that are remaining. So our funding strategy for the next infrastructure investment plan is gonna require a different strategy from the last time. We're gonna really need to look at the different funding programs available through the state and federal infrastructure investments and use that as a guide. But those are still materializing. Those are evolving as we speak, and we're going to hear a little bit more about that. We also want to talk about the potential of bond funding and what kind of impact that could have in terms of additional funds available to us for infrastructure needs, but also potential impacts on our annual maintenance budget. And then we also need to look at Measure A. And its anticipated for performance within the next 5 years. There is going to be a decrease in Measure A, and we need to take that into account as we develop the next 5-year infrastructure investment plan. We're also looking at our changing operations and our maintenance cost and potential improvements and enhancements to our operating budgets to better meet the needs of our different needs that we have. So for Measure A, just a reminder of the investments that we've been able to make across different programs, a total of just under $160 million. I noted the anticipated decrease between FY 23 and 27. And then in 28, we do expect Measure A to increase back to FY 17 through 22 levels, obviously pending City Council approval. But, you know, there is some additional revenue from Measure A that will become available at that point. So now I'm going to turn it over to Tyler, who's going to walk us through some of the slides associated with the state and federal funding.
Thank you, Eric, and thanks, Vice Mayor and Council, for the opportunity to provide an update related to state and federal infrastructure investments and opportunities. We did provide a similar update to our State Ledge Committee, as well as the Port Transportation Infrastructure Committee, over the last 2 or 3 weeks. So some of this information may be familiar, but provide just kind of an update of where we're at, especially on the federal side where the negotiations are continuing through this month. So at the state side, in this year's adopted budget, there were historic revenues and federal support through the Recovery Act funding, where now we have a $100 billion California comeback plan, which includes investments for long-term economic recovery and infrastructure that I think will be of interest to, of course, the council and the city as we develop some of these infrastructure priorities. There's funding related to the climate for water resilience, drought preparedness, safe drinking water, and so on. Climate resilience in disadvantaged communities. So this would be potentially help us advance our climate action and adaptation plan to address extreme heat, sea level rise, and also environmental equity. There's, of course, an interest statewide in advancing zero emissions goals by having all new vehicle sales be zero emissions by 2035, as well as medium and heavy duty vehicles by 2045. So, of course, significant investments in zero emission vehicles and charging infrastructure. And on the transportation side, there's also investments for high-speed rail, multimodal transportation projects, highways, roads, bridges, and other more local and regional rail projects. There's also investments in the state budget around digital inclusion, $6 billion total over multiple years for broadband infrastructure. And for us in particular, there's a $1 billion portion in this fund for urban jurisdictions to advance last mile services and infrastructure, which I think will be really vital for our digital inclusion efforts. There's funding for housing infrastructure as well, essentially Project HomeKey 2.0. Where, you know, provide long-term permanent affordable housing for people experiencing homelessness, as well as funding for behavioral health continuum infrastructure, treatment facilities and programs, and critical infrastructure like streets, parking, and utilities for affordable housing projects. There's also funding in here for the libraries, $439 million for an equity-based matching grant program for capital investment projects and technology upgrades at libraries throughout the state. And as you know, of course, there were also one-time funding opportunities at both the state and federal level this year. Given the significant surplus at the state level, the budget does include a number of one-time funding opportunities for Long Beach and other communities throughout California. Those include, of course, investments in parks and open space projects, community partnerships with Centro Cha and the Children's Clinic, as well as LBCC construction at their different campuses. And we just found out over the weekend also the inclusion of $1.5 million for a signature playground at Ramona Park as well. I just want to emphasize, of course, there was no clear application process at the state level. Most of these projects were decided by the delegation members. And, you know, reflect their interests as well as some of the conversations member to member. And at the federal level, we saw a very different process where the offices all had a clear application process and requested projects from the city with a pretty quick turnaround. So we selected projects based on priorities that reflected interests and needs across the city, so citywide priorities. And they were really looking for projects that had matching funds already, were shovel ready, could be potentially completed within 12 to 18 months. Also projects that had whatever required approvals they were requesting, like environmental approvals for transportation infrastructure, as well as, of course, wanting to reflect council direction and priorities for infrastructure. So of the projects that we requested or applied for at the federal level, we do have three community projects still in the running. And these projects are located in the annual appropriations bills for different departments. So that includes Signature Playground for Silverado Park, public safety training. That would be the ABLE training that we had talked about at council a little while ago, as well as funding potentially for Michelle Obama Library services and equipment. And on the more infrastructure related or transportation related infrastructure side, they did a separate track. And these requests are located in the Invest in America Act, which is the 5-year reauthorization for transportation infrastructure funding. And we do have three projects still in the running in this legislation. That would be $12 million for Anaheim Street Corridor, $8 million for Artesia Boulevard, and almost $1.5 million for our ADA curb ramps and sidewalks projects. So in terms of the larger infrastructure negotiations, there's been, of course, a lot of talk over the last year about what the federal priorities are, and we don't exactly know where this will land. But what we do know is, of course, earlier in the spring, the Biden administration released two plans of over $4 trillion total, which would invest over multiple years in physical infrastructure and what folks are calling human infrastructure and social supports, so things like expanded healthcare, education resources, and so on. And earlier this summer, the House passed the Invest in America Act. That's the bill I was just referring to. And this would reauthorize transportation and water infrastructure spending over 5 years for $715 billion. Again, this is the bill that includes those three highway and transit projects that we had requested for earmarks. Alongside that, though, the Senate has also moved forward with a separate package, in the last month or so, which we provided an update memo. This is the Senate bipartisan package, which was passed in the Senate on August 10th. And this is $550 billion in new spending for infrastructure. I'll walk through a little bit what's in that proposal, as well as almost $400 billion in the 5-year reauthorization for transportation infrastructure. So I want to emphasize here, of course, that this bill, the Senate passed version, does not include those city earmarks that were in the House bill. And of course, there's a significant difference in the funding amounts between the House bill and the Senate bill. So the last point here, of course, is that Democrats in particular have been pushing forward with a much larger $3.5 trillion package, which would go through the reconciliation process in the Senate, which would require just a simple majority instead of the 60 votes that are typically required for legislation. So what's in the bipartisan bill that has passed the Senate and is currently in the House? We do know, of course, high-level buckets of where the funding would be invested, but we also know kind of what the focus areas are through the narrative around the bill. So there's a significant focus on projects that have national or regional significance, projects that could advance equity and sustainability, as well as projects that may offer some workforce development opportunities and investments in infrastructure-related trades. So what you see here on this graph is sort of a highlight of some of the main categories of new spending on top of the 5-year reauthorization that I was just referring to. So there's, of course, significant investments in transportation, the Highway Trust Fund, highway programs through different state apportionments and surface transportation block grants, funding for new construction and rehabilitation of regionally significant bridges. There's also funding around the electric grid and expanding renewable energy. Rail projects from Amtrak all the way to more regional significant rail and freight projects. There's funding for broadband at the federal level as well. So this would help to provide more connectivity grants and opportunities for underserved areas. investments in water infrastructure, especially drinking water and replacing lead pipes, making sure that we have clean drinking water nationwide. Funding for resilience and cybersecurity efforts. Transit, airports, and ports also have significant funding pots in here that our airport and port would be eligible to apply for. There would be infrastructure for electric vehicle charging, $7.5 billion for a national network of EV chargers, as well as funding to reduce transportation-related carbon emissions, and funding as well for safety and research to advance the National Highway Traffic Safety Program and essentially Vision Zero projects in terms of designing safe streets for all investments. So what's not included in this bill? As mentioned, there are no direct city allocations in this bill. So not only do we not see the city's three earmarks related to infrastructure in this Senate-passed bill, but we also don't see direct city allocations for infrastructure like we've experienced recently with the COVID relief package. Instead, what the bill does is it really outlines a number of different state apportionments, expanded funding for existing and new programs, block grants, competitive grant programs, and also some formula grants like for the airports and ports, which we would be able to apply for. In terms of next steps for the federal infrastructure package, we still don't know exactly how the House and the Senate will align their different versions of the transportation infrastructure priorities. As mentioned, of course, the House proposal is significantly more investments in transportation infrastructure. They also have some policy differences. So there's still a question as to how the House and the Senate will align their different proposals related to infrastructure. And the House Speaker, as well as a number of Democrats, have said that they won't move forward with this bipartisan bill until they have a much larger infrastructure package. So this is where we get to the conversation around reconciliation and this larger $3.5 trillion infrastructure package. We know that the House and the Senate committees are currently working on drafting legislation around various infrastructure priorities that are not currently included in the bipartisan package. So this would be over and above what we know is in the bipartisan package, would include things like carbon emissions reductions programs, affordable housing, renewable energy, environmental justice programs, expanded Medicare, expanded child tax credit, universal pre-K, and tuition-free community college, as well as potentially immigration reform. So this bill, the reconciliation bill, will be significantly larger, as well as focus on different types of infrastructure investments. And we do anticipate, the deadline has been set for September 15th for the different budget committees to start marking up and drafting legislation. So we expect by next week to potentially have more details on those funding opportunities, and that to maybe move forward later this month, if not into the fall. So with that, I will pass it back over to our city manager.
Thank you very much. So I know we've talked a lot now about the projects and some of the funding opportunities. I want to kind of follow up with, as we're looking to put together our project list, kind of what is staff looking at, and get some input from the council, as well as talk about some local funding opportunities as well. So without having a lot of information about what we can actually apply for, since we're not getting direct money, we are kind of creating our own staff prioritization criteria as we look to try to rank these projects and try to figure out which ones we think will have the best chance for federal funding. And so we've done this before in some of our CIP projects as well. So one of the ones would be public health and safety, and that's the extent of which it improves or maintains public health. We look at the number of residents impacted, basically the higher use rates, the higher number of projects that we can potentially get some additional consideration. We look at urgency, how urgent is the project, and that there's adverse impacts if the project's not done. We look at the very poor condition versus the high need, and so that an existing facility that's in really bad shape versus one that's in better shape, and how does that factor into the need to move it now. Jobs, at which point can a project create a significant number of jobs and local hiring opportunities? Looking at the investment area, trying to do a regional distribution of projects while also looking at investment in disadvantaged or low-income communities, as we've talked about in some of our racial reconciliation plans. The ability to attract or additional funding or to leverage other funds. So how much can bringing in a little bit of federal money attract other types of funding and get us a better project? Looking at operational cost savings and revenue generation, to which point can we reduce our operating costs, save us money on our operating budget, or bring another revenue? And then finally, shovel ready. So a lot of the federal projects require you to basically be ready to go, and that has different definitions, which we'll revisit in a second. And so shovel ready, we're going to be putting these into different categories. In some cases, shovel ready means 6 months shovel ready. We saw that in when we were doing CARES Act. That was more projects that can be done and completed within 6 months. Those were not as much capital, but that was our 6 month window. Those basically mean your design is completed. They're very, very minimal. You've done your permitting process and ready to go. 12-month shovel-ready essentially means you still need a little bit of final design, but you've done already some permitting, or it's not required, or that you've already got most of that underway. 18-month shovel-ready is that you still need some significant design. You've started some permitting, environmental, business, and safety, but you haven't completed yet, or you still need to go through those steps. Anything beyond that really isn't considered shovel-ready, so things that are kind of at the conceptual phase. We also have brought to the council, it was brought by Councilmember Mungo to the council for us to really weigh in and take a look at bonding as an opportunity. That was brought earlier this year, and we brought back some specific financial information on bonding. Know that, as Eric talked about, we have had much higher investment in recent years than we've ever had in infrastructure, and that's due in large part to Measure A. But we know that that investment, even at that much higher level, is not enough to maintain our street condition. And that average, our spending is about 33 annually, and that in order to maintain that PCI at current levels, we should be at the $58 million a year. And that doesn't really include a major investment in kind of failed streets. We also know that more streets are in poor conditions, and it's difficult to address and still prevent those good and fair streets from failing and going into poor condition. And that those poor condition streets are the ones we get a ton of complaints about. They're also dramatically more expensive to repair. And that once they fail, they actually don't get more expensive over time, where others that are a little bit better looking and are in better shape actually do have the chance of falling into disrepair at a higher cost. A cost-effective street program, when we ask our engineers about this, requires attention to both areas, as well as a lot of attention to our good and fair streets to keep them from falling into disrepair, while also dealing with those very, very poor streets. And in November 2020 is when that council requested the analysis. And so bonding can provide some very positive benefits. It can provide some immediate funds for street repairs and for maintenance. They do add some interest costs, but they also have, you save on construction inflation and street deterioration. So there's definitely some positives there. We also do have some drawbacks. A bond does have debt service. Roughly, it's about for every $10 million in proceeds, you're getting about 0.95 million, about 950,000. Of debt service, and about $3 million of interest costs for every $10 million if you're assuming a 15-year bond. You aren't able to spend all those proceeds on the actual construction, and some of them do need to go for issuance costs, design costs, construction management, those types of things. Without a new revenue source, you do run into some budget problems where you're potentially reassigning funds away from other needs, which could include your annual street maintenance or future street dollars or other types of priorities that the council would decide. So there's really three common ways to pay for debt service, which is the annual cost of borrowing. The most straightforward approach is really looking at a brand new tax or a brand new assessment. That is the easiest. You go to the voters, you say, here's what would be the assessment, here's what the results would be, and you dedicate and link those two projects together. The next one is kind of taking an existing revenue source that becomes available. For example, if you had a bond in the past that got paid off and then you basically refund it or reissue it, or if you're looking at future dollars like in the potential of Measure A that's not currently planned, you could look to dedicate some of that. You could also look at reductions in lower priority services or infrastructure and essentially say this is a higher priority and take reductions in other areas in order to float a bond. There are some impacts on other priorities I want to make sure we're all aware of, is that we have a lot of priorities, as Eric just laid out. Streets, I hear from every single one of you, are really, really important, and we want to find ways to address those. We also have our legal requirements for sidewalk work. We have major infrastructure projects like Fire Station 9 that is unfunded. We have other fire stations. We have park facilities. We have HVAC systems that have been shutting down our facilities, forcing our staff to move out. We still need to find a solution for our permanent location for our police crime lab and property storage. We hear a lot from you about park restrooms, about community centers. We have failing roofs, et cetera, et cetera. And so as we look at, you know, what is our capacity for a bond, how does it affect operational budget versus capital versus Measure A, what also are the types of projects that are the highest priority, and how streets and sidewalks and parks and facilities all fit together. And also just something to look for the future. When you bond today, you're essentially spending some of that debt service for future councils and future projects, and that's something to pay attention to. And so the bottom line is we really do think that there needs to be kind of a long discussion about, you know, what are the priorities that this council has for future Measure A funds? How do you want to allocate those? Are streets, you know, where you want to focus? Are sidewalks, are public safety? There's a lot of tough discussions that we're going to be having over the next year. And what streets we pick also impact our long-term pavement condition. We get the most short-term impact by investing in those worst streets. I know you all hear about those. We all have them. They're on our lists, and we get questions, when are those going to get done? So there would be a short-term impact. When you look at the long-term CIP program, you actually get a more positive long-term impact for focusing on the good-to-fair streets to prevent them from falling into disrepair. And so it likely is going to be a mix of worst versus good and fair streets, and that'll be kind of a key to the issue of whether or not we are going to be improving our PCI over the long term, whether that's positive or negative. And so we have heard that there's interest in the council to look at this. I am recommending that we take that next step and that we develop kind of an example for you. We've given you some high-level information, but really taking that next step, sizing out something which is about a $5 million annual debt service. That, of course, can be adjusted up or down, which would start about $50 million in funding for Measure A. We would kind of look at a mix from $1.5 million from street alley maintenance and about $3.5 million from other types of infrastructure. We would then look to incorporate some more of those poor condition streets because we hear that as a priority. Not ready to do a specific PCI study right now. That was one of the recommendations, but we can certainly do that if we want to move forward. But this will give you some sense of what that would cost and look like. I do recommend, though, that we start looking at this early next year. We'll start the work, but you really should be looking at kind of, you know, spending any Measure A in the future as in the context of our FY23 budget status, which we expect at this point to be about $38 million next year. That could go down, could go up. If things improve, it could go down a little bit. And then look at, where are we with federal? What are we getting for our capital needs? What are some of the other sources that Tyler talked about? And have that larger discussion next year as we look at all of our priorities. And so that's pretty much it. Our next steps is we really need to start converting kind of some of our project ideas from a wish list to a short list. I'm seeking some input from the council either tonight or individually on kind of where you feel some of those top infrastructure criteria and priorities are. What are the projects? I hear from most of you. I think I know from most of you what your major priorities are, as we talk about them often, but make sure that you're letting us know what those are. We need to start linking some of these plans that Eric talked about with our financial capacity and planning those out. We need to get more details on what's in the federal infrastructure package and what we can apply for there versus what we're going to have to take care of locally. Really compiling that list of shovel-ready projects, using the input from those priorities and criteria to see where we'd be best positioned. And then next year, we'd return to the council with a new infrastructure investment plan. That was part of the council's direction in the last budget cycle, is to have a new five-year plan, and then start informing the public about what we can fund and how much we are able to do and what streets are up next and why, as well as other projects, and then continue to explore bond financing pending federal funding disbursements. So that's it. I know that was a lot. We look forward to having a good discussion with the council and getting your feedback. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Modica and Eric and Dr. Curley. I'm just pulling up my screen here. Okay, so I'm sure we'll have a lot of discussion here. Let's start with Councilwoman Mungo.
Thank you. Great presentation, very similar to what we saw at the Infrastructure Committee. I really appreciate that. Some of us have now been on the City Council for 7 years, some longer. And in a lot of these discussions, I just want to thank you guys because there was no data when we started. I mean, when we started in 2014 and there were 5 new council members and my question was, what are the conditions of the streets? We were just starting that road condition analysis. And I think that it's easy to say my road is horrible, but now we're able to really talk to residents about prioritization, what it means and what that does. However, when a street goes from, if you could show, I think it's like slide 6 or 7, when a street goes from very good to good or very good to fair, that cost variance, you're right, it's very small. But when you go from fair to very poor, there are charts that I've seen from our public works director that show a 50% increase in cost. And so when you talk about 3% or 4% of interest and maybe another 2% in administration / overhead or insurance on a bond, and you're talking about a fair street that's $10 to $17 a square foot going up to very poor, which is $25 to $30 a square foot, you're talking about a considerable tax savings to the taxpayer that I think that they would appreciate. And so I think we need to be strategic about what we do. I also think that now that we have all this data, we really need to take another step back and say, where should these resources go long-term? I like to hear the prioritization list that you guys have provided. I know we asked about it in the Infrastructure Committee, so I'm glad that that was added. But I don't know what the mix of this looks like. And I don't know that we've really done this as a council for all our major assets. I have heard from some librarians or retired librarians that, you know, maybe we need to look at a neighborhood library improvement program. I've heard from other individuals, you know, what's working with Michelle Obama Library is that it's a bigger hub library, and maybe we need to move to that theory or strategy. I don't know the right answer. I'd love to get subject matter experts that are library staff, community stakeholders, library foundation, and here where we go to kind of determine what does the future look like. Let's not just fix everything we have. Let's be strategic about where we want to be in 10 years. And I think the same is true of our parks. We have a lot of neighborhood parks, and those are important. And then we have a lot of discussion about, oh, well, this park needs a playground and this park needs a playground. What does the strategy look like on all accessible playgrounds? Should we have 3 in the city? If so, where should they be? Should we have 2 pools, 3 pools? I mean, we're talking about these big picture things, and we need to be strategic about what that looks like. Where are the fields? Where are the players coming from to play on what kinds of fields? Do we have enough soccer fields? Do we need to add lacrosse fields? Or is pickleball becoming the new fad for seniors that we really need to make sure is available to them? What does that look like? And where should these be? It can't always just be where space is available today. We need to think 10 years in the future and say, okay, the aging population is mostly where? The youth population is exploding where? Where do those fields need to be? Where do the bus lines need to be able to get people? Is that a realistic way to move people for these kinds of resources? And I think that kind of goes to, we talked about the building review. I think the building review is great. I'm glad we did it. But like-for-like improvement might not be the way to go. We really need to ask, what's the right number of all of these assets, and where is the right places for those assets to be, and be strategic about it. I'm going to tell you, public restrooms are huge. Having quality public restrooms, if you know my side of town, we've been working really, really hard to get those public restrooms improved. They're critical for health and safety. They're critical for need. They're just so old and deteriorated. They're very expensive to fix. So with that, I'm going to recue when my time's appropriate because I have a couple more things to tackle. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Price.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank staff for that presentation. It was very informative, and we did hear a lot of it in our PTI committee, but hearing it again and hearing some of the new information helps me understand the scope of the issue a little bit better. I do have a couple of questions. On page 10, we're talking about the different budgets. Can you talk to me a little bit more about our philosophy regarding our slurry budget? I know that we did a heavy slurry seal project in 17, and then it's gone away. And why is that?
The initial investment took a couple of years to implement, and it really allowed us to do a lot of deferred maintenance. As we've continued to deliver the Measure A plan, we do have a lot of commitments there in that plan. So there's a lot of different needs. So we had programmed some funding early on for slurry sealing, and we met that commitment. But then we've been focused on other streets, other facilities, other park improvements, and we haven't come around to making another investment specifically for slurry sealing since that FY 17 and 18 investment.
And I just wanted to add, that was Measure A. We don't really have a slurry sealing budget. We wanted to make a very quick impact with as many streets as we could for a low dollar amount to help arrest our PCI and keep it from falling. So that we essentially slurried every single street that was eligible in 17 and 18 and then moved on to street construction.
Are we still doing an assessment, though, to see if streets are now eligible for slurry? Because it does seem like it provides a lot of return on the investment.
Yes. As we revise the PMP, so the revised 2021 pavement management plan will have a new list of slurry eligible streets that will be identified.
Okay. And that list that PMP recommendation will be available by the fall, you said?
Yes. We're adding our finishing touches. Our consultants are in the quality control, quality assurance phase. Making sure the ratings and the numbers are all correct. They're just about done with that part. Once they finish that and turn it over to us, then we'll be able to share it.
Okay. I want to touch on one area that you talked about, and I know we talked about it in the PTI committee as well, and that's facilities. You know, I'm wondering if we can, and perhaps this is something that we can work on in PTI and recommend it to the full council, but using data to determine what the status of our facility usage is and whether we have some underutilized facilities that might be better served as either open space for the public to enjoy. We talk a lot about needing more open space in certain areas of the city, and having a building that's dilapidated that presents an infrastructure burden for the city, an unfunded infrastructure burden for the city, to me seems like a much less desirable use of that asset than even having it as open space, at least for a 5-10 year period of time until the money becomes available to build a facility there or rebuild a facility there that is usable and desirable for some sort of active use. So I would like to think about converting some of our underutilized facilities that may not even be in a habitable condition to open space if we can, and what the costs associated with that would be. So I'd like us, and that's something that, assuming my colleagues think that's a good idea, the committee can really take up and start evaluating how we're approaching our facility assets and where we're deciding to put that money in and what criteria we're using, because it would be wonderful to have more open space in the interim until we have the money to do what we need to. And then finally, you know, my recommendations in general regarding this entire presentation is based on what Dr. Curley has presented and what the city manager has presented in regards to what shovel ready means. It seems to me that it's a great investment for us to figure out how to get the design portion of all of our projects up to a place where they are no longer just a vision, but something concrete. I know we have several projects like that in the third, and I'm sure my colleagues do in their districts as well, where the funding for the design project is keeping that vision from becoming a reality, and a small investment into the design process will take it from an idea or a vision to something that potentially could be funded if federal or state dollars became available. And so I really would like to focus on that. And I know, like for me, we have a $30 million water quality project. It's not a sexy or exciting project. It won't come with a fancy ribbon cutting, but it's an essential project that's designed to help activate the bay and keep the bay healthy. And so, you know, we're talking about the design part phase of that project now. That project, if money became available for a competing grant, might not be able to make it if it's not at a place it needs to be from a design standpoint. So I appreciate the presentation and your courtesy. Thanks.
Thank you. Next is Councilwoman Sorrow.
Thanks, Vice Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Lopez, for that presentation, as well as Mr. Demotica and Dr. Curley. I'm still trying to understand this pavement management plan as far as how do you approach prioritizing, you know, which roads to fix, right? Because, you know, just looking intuitively, when you see very poor roads, you think, you know, we should fix all of it just because it's just so bad. But at the same time, I'm trying to understand how is it cost more effective to maybe fix the fair to marginal and poor versus if we decide not to do all of the very poor?
Yes, council member. So it comes down to the value you get from your investment. When you look at the cost of repair per square footage of your very poor streets, it can be as high as $30 a square foot. And when you compare that to maintaining our streets in good or in fair condition, it could be half of that amount. So the PMP recommends, you know, get a handle on your good streets. Stop the rate of degradation. Crack seal, slurry seal your street roadway so that you prevent those segments, those streets, from going from good or fair to poor or very poor. And then once you have control of that and you've eliminated your rate of degradation, then they say then focus on the backlog, your streets in poor and very poor condition, and get that backlog to under 20%. And that's where we're at right now. I think we're at 26%. So if we were to just theoretically focus all of our budget on very poor streets, we would be doing half of the amount of maintenance that we do, and the rate of degradation will just create a bigger backlog. So yes, we'll get to a few streets that are in very poor condition, but the amount of our streets in that category will continue to increase because we wouldn't be able to address our streets in good. We wouldn't be able to keep our streets in good and in a fair condition at that good condition. So just the cost of crack seal and slurry sealing versus the cost of a complete rebuild.
So is there a condition worse than very poor?
Nope.
Is it just undrivable? Like, do you block it out then?
Once you get to very poor, the cost of repair, whether it's a 5 or a 20, the cost of repair, it doesn't increase very much. Right, but when you go from a street from fair to poor, you know, you're going from $10 to $17 to $17 to $25, and then even higher to very poor. So it's just, you know, there is a difference in the rate of decline and to improve those segments.
Thank you. I have one more question, and it's the, you know, one of the three earmark federal project, the Anaheim Street Corridor, should it not make it into the reconciliation budget? Is that where it's a possibility to explore these other funding options?
Yeah, so at this point, those three earmarks related to infrastructure, they were passed by the House, and we don't know exactly what the House and the Senate are going to do. One option could be that the House tries to incorporate the earmarks into their, you know, proposal related to the larger reconciliation package, or potentially they could even try to do a different bill later, an omnibus bill for all the earmarks. There may be other vehicles. We just don't know exactly where those earmarks will land at this point.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
All right, Councilwoman Allen.
Thank you, Vice Mayor, and Thank you, Mr. Modica and Director Curley and Director Lopez for your presentation. I just have a couple of questions. What are the main contributors to the damage of our asphalt roads?
I have our assistant city engineer next to me, Keith Hoey, here, and he's always telling me, water. We have to stop water from going into those cracks in the street, because one crack turns into five cracks turn into 25, and then it's just a significant rate of the deterioration from there. So I would say the major cost is water. I think we've been lucky in the last few years that we haven't had a lot of rainfall. But you know, that is one of the biggest factors that deteriorate our streets.
Awesome. And my next question, so you talk about cost per square foot, which is good, but what is the cost per block of a residential street for those repairs? I think it would be easier for me to kind of wrap my head around that as opposed to the square foot, if you have any estimates. Like, what is the cost per mile or per street?
So it's going to differ based on the block and the length of the block and where it's at. If it's a local street, very different from a major secondary street. While my team does some math back here, I would also point out that a big part of the cost for our street improvements is the concrete work, sometimes up to 75%. And not as much sidewalk repairs, but more curb and gutter and drainage that's required to keep that water out of the street and going into our storm drain system. We invest in those improvements as we go and rebuild or improve our streets. So that's a big part, but we'll get you a cost scenario soon.
Speaking of the storm drain system, so is there a difference between the cost of the travel lanes and the parking lanes for roadway maintenance? And is there a difference in priority?
Can you repeat the question?
So I want to see, is there a cost difference between the travel lanes and the parking lanes for roadway maintenance? And then is there a difference in the priority of the maintenance?
You know, the street segment is a street segment. So if we're going to go in and improve a street, it doesn't matter kind of where it's at. It's going to all get improved. It is one asphalt pavement area. You know, obviously the curb and gutter and sidewalk is closer to where the parking area is, but you know, I would say it's the entire effort that we look at, and we don't distinguish between one or the other.
Okay. All right, and then my next question, I still have a little bit of time left. So basically we're paying to keep little roads that in good repair, and the more used roads also need repair. So my question for you is, does the PCI take into account the longevity of the road or the intensity of the traffic on the road?
So traffic volumes does impact the condition of the street. And, you know, when we develop our pavement condition index, you know, we look at the surface condition and at the structural condition. But yes, volume of cars and traffic does have a greater impact over time on a street. So there is a higher volume streets do tend to require more repair or repair sooner than say a residential street or even an alley that may not get the same amount of volume.
Okay. And then one last question. So it's $58 million per year to maintain the PCI. Is that realistic in the future? Do we just have too many lane miles of road?
We are a large city, lots of roadways. You know, I think as we continue to develop as a city, we want to look at opportunities to increase our investment on our streets. We also want to look at opportunities to do more in-house maintenance, like crack sealing and slurry sealing. And we may be able to bring costs down, but those are longer-term efforts. It's just, you know, every city has a lot of streets. I wouldn't say we have too many streets. I would say, you know, historically, we've had challenges in adequately funding our street network. We've all know about our fiscal history, and some years you have money to invest in infrastructure and some you don't. And we've had some very tough budget years where we've cut maintenance, including street maintenance, because that's what was necessary. But, you know, as we continue to grow and plan out, you know, this is an area of focus for us to see what kind of opportunities there are to continue growing our investment in our street maintenance programs.
And I'd like to add to that, if I could. I don't want to take too much of your time, council member, but we also have not been a city that where the voters have invested in infrastructure before Measure A. This is the very first time we've really had that. The last time we can think of was back in the 1960s. We had a municipal bond. And since that time, we've invested like $800 million into our community college. We've invested $1.2 billion into our Long Beach Unified School District. And out of Measure A, we had about $150 million investment in our streets and sidewalks and facilities. So it really, you know, it's been a years and years and years of deferred maintenance. And now we're kind of looking at how do we make that larger investment.
All right. Thank you. Councilman Austin.
Thank you. And this has been a really, really great presentation, a good discussion. I'll try to be brief. I took a little few notes here. The 5-year infrastructure improvement plan, I believe, has to be bold as we lay it out and address our needs. I think there's a few things that weren't kind of considered when we passed Measure A that has kind of come up, and you, I think, brought that up. You know, the ADA lawsuit and the curb repairs is pretty significant, as well as, you know, I know for a fact we have a fire station and then some other needs that weren't necessarily envisioned when we laid out our initial plan. And so I'm very, very aware of that. But I think our constituents, our residents, you know, they were sold a very ambitious plan. And Measure A was our vehicle to deliver. And so I think we should do all we can to leverage those funds to deliver for our neighborhoods throughout the city. I will comment on the chart in front of us. I think we all strive to be excellent, right? I think the residents of Long Beach would accept good right now, right? We're very good. And so perhaps that number can be adjusted there, and we can be realistic with our aspiration as far as getting to a place where our pavement management plan is one that is acceptable and one that we all can work and be proud of. And I think we should obviously prioritize safety of our residents here when it's coming to it, as we speak towards infrastructure. There was a slide where you had, and you said you wanted to talk to the council or about prioritization. And I think we should add risk to that location. And I think Councilmember Allen also mentioned frequency. I can tell you that when it came to, and when we had control of our sidewalk budgets, there was we looked at geographic areas that were well traveled, areas that were close to churches, to schools, accessing to our business districts. I think we have to be strategic in utilizing those funds to minimize risk to the city as well. And so when we talk about prioritization, I think those factors need to be also considered. And then I saw a presentation related to the federal infrastructure plan. And there were a couple of projects identified that were particular earmarks there. I know we had a lot of conversation over the last several months about green space, park space along the LA River, San Gabriel Valley River. My question, or San Gabriel River, my question is, has, and I've written letters to our specifically to our congressional representatives related to getting funding for LA River earmarked in any sort of federal infrastructure package. I guess the question is for you, Mr. City Manager and Dr. Curry, are we looking at, or have we, are we requesting funds for those potential projects as well?
So those could be considered as part of the greater infrastructure package. We do think that there will be some opportunities for open space. When we did the original ones, when we got, we had a pretty regulated process from our federal government about what we could ask for. There really wasn't any opportunity in a bill to fund like an open space type project. We were looking more towards transportation. And so that's where most of those came in, were transportation. There were some related to programming and kind of public safety areas and library services. This next round, we think projects, especially now that we've gotten some additional funding from our state that we can show as matching dollars, that would be a project we could ask for.
Thank you, and I'm going to hold you to that, sir. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you. Councilman Supernaw.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. I don't need a response. I just need to state this for the record. I've said it many times before that I would love to see projects, one-off projects, that the council office is funding on their own be expedited to have those come to fruition. It may not look like it puts a dent in those staggering numbers that we saw in this presentation, but it pays huge dividends with customer satisfaction out there in the district. And lo and behold, it might even move the needle on our ADA lawsuit. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll go ahead and add my comments here. Very healthy, very good discussion. I have a number of points that I want to make. Let's see. So one thing on page 9, you showed the street map with all the progress in the last 5 years. I'm not sure how updated this is. I definitely see a portion of South Street on there that says it's paved. I can tell you it's not complete. So I'm not sure. I think we need to double check on that. Secondly, a point I want to make is that when we're thinking about, and some of my colleagues might have kind of like touched on this a bit, when we're talking about infrastructure need, the facility condition index doesn't account for communities that don't have the facilities at all. And we need to make sure that we think about, from a facility standpoint, you know, what investments, what plans, what designs need to be done in order to make sure that we are, you know, closing the gap and expanding access to these facilities. You know, particularly, you know, we've talked about pools. We most recently built a new library, you know, different things that didn't exist before, but there's still areas of town that still don't have basic facilities. So we need to think about that. Next, you know, I certainly want to thank Tyler, your work, and our state legislative delegation and our federal legislative delegation. They did a great job this time. And I said in the Fed Leg Committee, in the State Leg Committee, that we need to do a bit more work to make sure that all parts of our town were included. And we're glad to see, and thank you for highlighting it. You know, I did reach out to Speaker Rendon, and he was able to do a trailer bill. And so now we finally are getting a signature playground, $1.5 million in the trailer bill in the budget for Mona Park. That's huge. You all have heard me for a long time talk about we're the only district that hasn't built one of those signature playgrounds. So we're happy to finally get a signature playground. So that's good. And the congressional delegation has done a great job. We want to make sure that we see those projects through. I know we're not done with the process, but please keep us up to speed. There's some really important projects on that federal list. Next, on slide 23, you don't have to go there, but on slide 23, when you talk about the prioritization of projects, I'm glad to see jobs as listed there. You know, in my opinion, sometimes you get more people invested in a project when you can show that it has local job benefit across the city. Belmont Pool is an example. You know, we were able to really talk about the job impact and local hire, which got more folks across the city more invested in that project. And I think, you know, we can learn from that process. If there are projects that are significant and we have a citywide project labor agreement and were able to get an economic benefit. I want to know about that as we prioritize projects. On slide 40, I think we're talking about, on slide 40, we're talking about the bond. So here are some of my thoughts on the bond. So one, I would like to see us explore not just measure A. How much do we receive in gas tax every year? That is dedicated to streets. How much do we receive in measure R every year? That is dedicated to streets. Measure A, we have a level of flexibility to invest in public safety as well. And what I don't want to do is dedicate the measure A to the extent where we have to cut paramedic rescues, cut police officers, cut, you know, I saw what it was like when we went 7 years without measure, without Rescue 12, and we had a 3-minute response time slower than others. So what I wouldn't want to do is leave that to a future council if we make that decision here. So let's look at how we can diversify. So I guess first question is, do we have the numbers annually, what we receive on gas tax and on measure R?
I'll need to pull those up, if we can come back to that.
Okay. Because, you know, if all you're doing is 5 years, you know, $5 million on measure A, you know, perhaps we could look at, you know, if we're receiving $2 million or $3 million here or there from these other funds that are dedicated to this, we can perhaps take the pressure off of measure A by focusing there. So let's bring the complete picture back when we come back and look at it. Like, how much of a dent? Maybe we can grow it to where it's more than $50 million we can put into streets today. But I think we definitely want to start with the funding that is dedicated towards streets. Another thing I want to mention, you know, we talked about this before, and I just want to highlight it again. We haven't done a real analysis on establishing infrastructure districts. We know that there are areas of town that are, you know, hard hit by heavy trucks. West Side, North Long Beach, you know, you have areas of town. We talked about the weight of a truck or the amount of traffic will speed up, you know, how fast a street will degrade. We have to look at establishing districts, just like redevelopment, just like we used to have, where the future growth, the future revenue receiving those districts are reinvested into the maintenance of those communities. And so if we know that Studebaker has high traffic, or Artesia Boulevard, or, you know, Santa Fe, due to whatever condition it is, then we can look at establishing a district there and taking future revenue and taking care of those streets, the maintenance of those streets in the long term. And you can bond against that as well. So it may be an option to explore. Not many cities have done it in the wake of redevelopment, but the tool is there and it's gotten better over time. The legislature has improved this tool. So before we move with a bond, these are things we need to explore, whether there's a way to leverage future revenue or dedicated sources of revenue that we have in order to do a better job at maintaining these areas. And then the last thing I'll say is, I think Mike Conway, when he was Public Works Director, I loved his approach. What he would do was every year, this is where the customer service piece comes in that Councilman Supernaut was talking about. He would come out to the budget meeting or whatever it was, and he would hear from the residents what the like most important street was. And it's typically a street that they all can agree on. And although we couldn't pave it, he put it in design. He would get that street into design to where it's designed and ready for the next year, and if funding is available, he's made those residents happy because they said it was a priority. I can tell you, a lot of the residents, you know, they were told in the 5-year infrastructure plan, South Street, for example, would be done. It's been, you know, it's going on 5 years. South Street isn't done. Sometimes you as the Public Works Director or us as the council members, we know outside of what the pavement condition plan may say, we know what the people are telling us. We need the flexibility to design it, get it in the pipeline to get it done now, so the people see that we are being responsive to their needs. So just some of my thoughts and feedback. Overall, I think this was a great presentation and a great discussion. I look forward to future discussions. Councilmember Mungo?
Thank you. I appreciate that you brought up the infrastructure district. It does restrict some of our flexibility for the future. And there's only certain parts of our city that really have as much opportunity for growth. But I think it's a really healthy discussion, especially when you talk about our state revenue funding areas and where those are coming from. I do want to hit back on two things that have come up through the years. One is we talk a lot about what's underneath the street. So Councilman Price and I have been working with Councilmember Supernaut on Studebaker for 6 years. And Studebaker is one of those streets that Councilman Richardson talked about where everybody knows it needs to be fixed, and it has high, high volumes of traffic and high, high complaints because such a high volume of the community partake in that street. And then there's all the things underneath that street that need to be fixed. And we, as a council, made a decision that we wanted all the things underground to be fixed before we do the street repair. We want the vaults to be fixed by Edison, and we want to make sure the water lines and the sewer lines and all of that's done. One of the things that I haven't seen, though, is the mayor made a point to talk about edge-to-edge resurfacing when someone goes into our streets. Because one of the things that you will see a lot of is in neighborhoods that are not due for street repair anytime soon, they may have a fair street. When one of these agencies goes in and makes a repair, you talk about water being what the damage point is. Those seams of where they repaired are the first places that end up getting all those potholes that end up degrading quickly over time. And I know the mayor asked about what are the possibilities of requiring edge-to-edge repair. How much additional cost is that? How does it get passed back to the taxpayer? We don't want to overburden it so that these agencies don't want to do the repairs that are necessary and important. But where's that balance in some of our fair streets and what that looks like and where those potholes are coming from? Additionally, I'm glad you brought this up, but when you said that water's the number one issue, I leaned over to Councilman Richardson and said, and volume and weight of vehicles on that street. Because volume and weight are huge factors, and we need to think about that in the prioritization process. If the volume, and I can tell you again, like you said, the four major streets on the east side, Conant, Wardlow, Studebaker, Clark. These streets have been the push since day one of when I was elected. We're getting a piece of them or all of them repaired by the end of my second term, which is great, but there's been a lot of other streets that have been repaired that the community has not felt were very important, and I recognize and appreciate the chart and where we are with that chart and why we've done some of those things, but Willow's about to get paved. Why do I know? Because Measure A signs are all up everywhere, and I know this is an important project to you, but I'm getting calls. Why is Willow getting repaired? Wardlow still hasn't been repaired yet, and so these dialogues are happening in our communities, and we have to be able to provide that information. On the slide where it talks about the $58 million in annual need to maintain, what percentage of that steady state number is for crack and slurry repair versus repave? Because my understanding is we have not started a crack repair program yet. Am I misunderstanding?
No, we have not. And that's the recommended amount. And we, I don't know what the percentage is, so I would need to look that up in the upcoming PMP and provide that. But you are correct. We don't have a current crack seal or slurry seal program, but we are looking at that using some of our internal resources.
And I recognize that you mentioned, and I want to just praise you for this now because it was a complaint a lot in 2016 and 2017, quality control. Some of those first round slurry seals were terrible. They had tire marks in them. They had other things that they came back and said, oh, those aren't for the infrastructure. But it's more than just infrastructure. It's the look and feel of a community when you have a brand new street that has tire marks through it. It's completely unacceptable. And I appreciate that I was able to work with the prior public works director to get refunds and partial credits for the future, but we have to stay on top of that. The more we're repairing and the faster they're working, the potential mistakes come up, and we have to control for that. I'd really like to see if you're bringing back an email or a memo or a TFF that has some of the answers for some of the things we didn't know. I'd really like to see that $58 million broken out, and what does that mean? And then we talk a little bit about the PCI backlog is 26%, and you state that backlog above 20% becomes difficult to sustain. What kind of number is necessary to get rid of and improve all the poor streets? The biggest return on investment I see on this chart is from $17 to $30. Even from $17 to $25 or $25 to $30, those numbers in there. Councilman Sorrow mentioned the poor streets and how much that would cost. She's absolutely right. Our biggest return on investment is not the poor streets. It's the very poor streets. It's the poor streets. So if we have the opportunity to talk about what those poor street numbers are and what that cost is, and then what percentage that impacts the backlog number, That would be helpful.
Thank you. Councilwoman Zendejas?
Thank you, Vice Mayor. I just want to second what my colleagues have said, and I think it's very, very important that we do take into consideration the weight and the traffic that is on some of these streets, especially in the west side. We have a lot of streets that are damaged there and that are considered to be worse streets and that are not being paid attention to, and yet they continue to be worse streets. So I'm, like you guys have always heard me talking about this in the past, that I really would like to see some kind of attention towards those worst streets, and maybe we can work together on a program to address some of these issues and really make sure that we can make a difference on those neighborhoods.
All right. Thank you so much. One more?
Yep.
All right. Councilman Mungo.
Thank you. I'm trying to be respectful of my 5-minute increments. Earlier you said on the presentation towards the end that there are more certain revenue streams that we could talk about. And I know Councilmember Richardson talked about some of those, but I'd be interested to know, because one of your other criteria was not fully planned. And my concern is that in presentations from Mr. Gross in the past, if you take the current revenue streams that are dominant funders of the city, property tax, et cetera, they are increasing at a lower rate than our annual cost of just our salary and employee benefits, much less our other costs. So when you talk about the bond, I think it's important that if you're going to say not fully planned, the exception to that is we're planning to use it for streets. Can we use it for streets early? Great. And then you said, what is the biggest possibility of the short-term impact? I think that goes back to what Councilman Saro was saying, which is the poor streets. But I also think we need to look about the facilities. And I know that Councilman Zendejas and Councilman Price and I kind of had this conversation at the Infrastructure Committee. There are some opportunities, really, for us to say, Facility A is a facility that has been requested to be supported or utilized by a community partner for X amount of time. And what is that time period in a future agreement with them where they would take on all the work for us? What would that mean? What does that look like? If we have a facility that costs $7 million to repair, if we were to rent it to them, how long would it take for them to have rented it from us at the cost of $7 million? And then instead of paying rent, they do those repairs and give it back to us in a condition that's better than where we are today. We as a city need to think about that. On page 10, you talk about, on page 10, I look at this chart of how we're spending the funding. And it really looks to me like we're doing some blocking, right? So in year one, we blocked slurry seal and arterial streets. Year two, we continued to block arterial streets and doubled down on residential streets. Year three, we doubled down again on residential streets and increased it up and continued that for two additional years, with then a drop-off of $9 million in FY21 on those residential streets. What is the strategy behind that? Is it based on connectivity and the ability to save funds? What does that look like? Slide 10.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, Council Member. Just different. This is only a snapshot of the measure of the measure investments within the mobility program. But we also, our Measure A infrastructure investment plan also included significant, substantial investments in facilities and parks and other improvements. As we go and fund some of those, for example, the PD Academy is a recent one. We did a $10 million set aside. That has to be taken into account. And obviously, that's going to impact other programs on a particular year. I also want to highlight that when you look at FY21, our total gas tax revenue that we got from the state was $11.5 million. You compare that to what we're getting this year, which is $16
million.
So that is a substantial difference. It goes up and down. We can't project that. That's a number we get from the state on a yearly basis, and then we program it accordingly. Just another consideration.
That makes a lot of sense. And also, I think you said Measure A, but I may have misheard. This is the infrastructure street investment history of all funds.
Correct. I apologize about that. Correct.
You were saying that 38 are all possible. And I wrote down, what is the mix? Let me go to that slide really quickly to see if I can understand what that question returned back to. Oh, you were talking a little bit about the mix of the things we need to spend money on. And I just want to say, I've heard Mr. Modica say this before, and I completely agree. In no way is it intended that the bond would only fund streets. I think that we need to talk about the same types of opportunity for investment on some of these facilities. There are areas where we can use the money today and save money long-term. Construction costs have escalated in the last 12 months at a rate far greater than interest and admin overhead. So with all of those things, I look forward to hearing you come back. And then I would love to hear a little bit more detail on the staff prioritization criteria so that the council can have a dialogue about what that means. Because when I see them way down on the list, and I'm guessing these aren't in priority order, attract additional funds, I think that percentage makes a big difference. If you have a project that's $10 million and you have to put up 9 to get 1, great. But if you have a project that you only have to put up 5 to get 5, to me, move that to the top of the list. You just saved the local tax costing $5 million. And I think we need to talk about what that looks like and have a real transparent process. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any public comment on this item?
No public comment.
Thank you. Members, please cast your vote.
Councilman Austin? Motion carries.
Okay, and I need to open up public comment one more time, right? Is there any public comment to close this meeting? No?
No public comment.
Okay, all right. So we are done with this study session. We'll be back in 15 minutes to open up the council meeting. Thank you.